Hello, it's Ilja, and I hope you all are having a wonderful day. Today I will do a reading week, and I will talk about the books that I finished this week, and also what I'm currently reading, and my reading plans for the upcoming week. The first book that I finished was Daisy Jones and the Six by Taylor Jenkins Reid. This is very much a booktube darling, and a hyped book, and I tend to avoid hyped books as much as possible, but this one I couldn't resist, and I'm very glad that I couldn't, because this is a very good book. It does have its flaws, but I very much enjoyed it. This is set mainly in the 70s, and we are following this band called Daisy Jones and the Sixth, and we are following their race to fame and also their fall as a rock band. And I think that Taylor Jenkins Reid captures the atmosphere of the music scene in the 70s in a very good way, and I really loved reading about it. And also I loved reading about being on tour, being on stage, rehearsals, arguments in the band, and also the creative processes with writing songs. I thought everything was really, really good, and it felt very real. I also very much enjoyed a lot of the characters, especially the female characters were very strong. We have Daisy Jones herself. She is this young woman. She is a it girl, and it seems like everything she does gives her success. But underneath everything, she is also this very vulnerable woman, and she is trying to numb her feelings down with drugs. And it is quite difficult to read about her downward spiral towards destruction, and I really cared about her. Another character that I very much enjoyed was Camilla. And she is the complete opposite of Daisy Jones. She is the wife of Billy, the main singer of the band. And she has this calmness to her. She knows what she wants, and she fights for it. But she does that in a very subtle way, and I grow to love her as well. And last but not least, we have Karen. She is the keyboardist in the band, and she wants to be recognized as a great musician, not just a great female musician. So she is such a wonderful feminist. She is very unapologetic, and she makes decisions that is right for her, but at the same time very hard both for her and people around her. So, yeah, I love these three characters, and there are others as well. One thing, though, that I felt was lacking in this book was more depth to the characters. As I said, I really liked them, but I wanted to know more about them. I wanted to dig deeper, and that didn't happen. I do think this has to do with the format of this book. It is written like a big interview where this invisible author interview not only the band but people that were working with the band and also people that were part of the musical scene at that time. So there's a lot of characters talking about the band and the scene and everything, and because of that there isn't much room for this big dive into certain characters. I think one other thing that I missed due to the format is that minor yet important characters were portrayed more one-dimensional than they needed to be. As I said, I really missed the digging. I would like to dig deeper into several of the characters. But there is one thing that this format does that really works well for the story, and that is that they are talking about key episodes, and it's very interesting to see how these key episodes are interpreted completely different by the different people that were there, and that is cool. And I think that is one of the reasons why the author chose to do it this way. Yeah, I really enjoyed this book. I was captured by the atmosphere and the music, and even though this is not a real band, I was longing for the music throughout this book, and that's a good thing. Another book that I read is one of my favorite books of the year, and that is Ice Cream Man by W. Maxwell Prince, Martin Morazzo, and Chris O'Halloran. This is volume 2, and a couple of months ago I read the first volume, and I first heard about this series through Damien at Sleepy Reader, and I will of course leave links to his channel in the info box. These are stories set in the same suburbia, and there is one character, the ice cream man, that is lurking in the background of every story. And these stories are described as feel-bad stories, and I couldn't agree more. But I think that's a good thing. In general, I can say that all the stories has elements of sadness to them. They have elements of absurdity, and they are very grotesque. The first story is the ballad of a falling man. And in this one, we meet a man who is standing on the top of a tall building. It's an office building, and he jumps. And we are following him falling down to his certain death. And at the same time, we're also getting peeks into what are going on in the offices, and they are so like nightmares. And it's really fascinating to see like the calm way he is like falling down, and at the same time see the craziness that is happening on the inside. I'm not sure what this story is trying to tell me, but nonetheless, I very much enjoyed it. And also, this story introduces a new character, a man in black, which reminds me a lot about the man in black from the Westworld series. So that was also very interesting. The next story is called Strange Neapolitan. And here we are following a man who buys an ice cream, a Neapolitan, from the ice cream man. And then he goes home, but it takes 3 different paths to his house, and there are 3 complete different stories. Like the Neapolitan ice have 3 different tastes. And the first one seems very happy in the beginning, but it's a story from Ice Cream Man, so of course it can't end happy. So it's quite devastating and sad. The other story is a little strange one, but also, I'm not sure, I think it's really strange, but it's about him and a dog, and it's cute in a way, but also strange. The last one is completely absurd. It starts with some maggots in the ice cream, and it just goes to a whole other place after that. It's completely, completely absurd. The third story is My Little Poltergeist, which is about grief and loss and coming to terms with losing someone that you love. And it's seen through the eyes of a 9-year-old girl, and she has lost her best friend to cancer. And as a coping mechanism, she still has her as this invisible friend. And her parents are worried, and they want her to realize what has happened. And she goes out on this quest, and she meets the ice cream man, and it's like a nightmare. It is really grotesque. And then she comes to terms with what has happened. It's a heartbreaking story. It's beautiful, but really heartbreaking. Then my favorite story, which is called Emergencies. This, I think, is the story that is closest to the existential horror. It's fantastic. It's about these two ambulance drivers who are driving through the suburbs, and they are completely ignorant to everything that has happened. There are riots, there are fires, people are getting killed or eaten by like maggots, and they are completely ignoring everything. They are just sitting there talking and popping pills, and they are so numb to everything that is going on, and it's so absurd, and it's so strange, and so alienating in a way. But it's very good. There is a narrator of the story that you don't know who he is in the beginning, but at the end it makes some kind of sense. One other thing that I enjoyed with this volume is the subtle way they're all connected. You have the man in black who you can see throughout all the stories. In the Strange Neapolitan, you meet characters from the previous volume, and that was kind of neat. And the same goes for the Emergencies story, where they are at the same diner as the musician in the first volume. So I really like that they are connected in a way that you need to like really pay attention to see it. But it's there, so I think that's a quite funny perk. But yeah, I highly recommend you to check out Ice Cream Man if you haven't. It is such an amazing series, and I ended up giving it 5 stars on Goodreads. The same as I gave Clarice Lispector. That should tell you something. I am currently reading Brother in Ice by Alicia Kopf. I think the writing in this is superb, but it's so fragmented and it's so disjointed, and it lacks a lot of coherence, especially the first part that I finished yesterday. So I'm not sure where this will go. I am not sure what will happen or what she is trying to tell me, this author and the narrator, but so far I am very immersed in the language and the fragments, but I am still pretty clueless. I will have to put Brother in Ice aside for a week, because next week there is Halfoweenathon. It's a weekly readathon where you are supposed to read horror. And even though I suck at readathons and I suck at TBRs, I will try to participate because I want to read more horror. This readathon is hosted by Megna Sue at Spinebreakers. Hey Little Drifter, that was She Read, and Carol Marie Reads. And they have made several prompts, and I will leave all of them in the info box. I have picked 2 prompts that I will try to read from. The first is to read a book that is adapted into a movie, and then watch the movie. And I have chosen Burnt Offerings by Robert Morasco. This is a haunted house story, and it's made into a movie. I don't know how easy it is to get hold of the film though, but I will try. The other one that I've chosen is to read something different or something other than a novel. And I have picked a collection of short stories by M.R.James. And I will not read every short story, but I will read some of them. And this was recommended to me by 64-page special. And I will of course leave links to him as well. And that was all from me today. Thank you so, so much for watching. If you have read any of these books, please let me know what you thought of them. And until next time, ha det!